additional efforts, and obviously that's a comparative statement, but in real terms. We've developed our thinking significantly around strategic ticketing, including new technologies, products, different types of zoning approaches, pricing, and indeed learning a lot more about the ITSO standard and what it can and can't do for us. And there are obviously still some challenges ahead. They are that obviously we've got some complex and historic processes to deal with there, and even some legislation. We have independent commercial operators all in the same mix, and sometimes there are differing ideas and positions that need to be discussed and agreed. We have we've taken the cap out of the bottle, really, in that we've now opened people's eyes to what smart ticketing can do, and I think from that there's now a wave of demand for smart-based ticketing, actually many from you guys, but that wave of demand is certainly there and real. We currently have limited resources, specifically around people and money. As I mentioned, we've got a 40-year-old ticketing scheme that is unique, interesting, slash complex, confusing, that we have to deal with. We've got some technical limitations around it, so it's not the most enjoyable technology to work with. And there are some other complexities and dependencies going on in our industry that we need to be aware of and linking with, for example, the Buses Bill, Transport for the North, and obviously our own Bus Alliance. So, what's next? Two things, really. We want to build on what we've already done, so do more of the same good stuff. Most specifically, we want to make the Boris Card the platform for ticketing in our Liverpool City region. How we go about doing that, we've got two chunks of thinking I want to share with you. First, around short and medium term, which is 1 to 2 years in our terminology. And under that framework, we want to take more products, and we want to add those to the Boris platform. And we want to take the functionality that we have and start to develop that and enhance that a little bit further. Secondly, in the longer term, we want to look to build with Transport for the North and the work that they're doing. We want to make sure that we have a common approach. We don't want to end up doing something different to everybody else in the Transport for the North region. We want to be able to access the funding that Transport for the North obviously opens up to us. And probably most important from my perspective is around the Transport for the North brings economies of scale that we as the Liverpool City region may not be able to attract on our own. So from that, we believe that we can build an intelligent back office system. So what does that mean? That means that rather than take a digital product and have to put it onto a card before then the card is read, which is all very complex and difficult, it takes all that technology, all that processing, and puts it into a clever system in the background. That allows us to deliver best-of-breed ticketing to get consistent peak and off-peak times, or even remove those if it doesn't make sense to have them, and make it generally easier all around. Particularly when you think about one of the retail networks we're using is pay points. They are people in shops who are not necessarily familiar with the transport sector. They do their very best, but the simpler we can make for them, the better service they can have to our customers. We want to create new products or even remove old products as and where it makes sense to do so. So, for example, we have considered creating a new ticket under the solo product range on a single day and being able to sell that as one or multiple, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, for example. And potentially look at removing tickets that don't have a great deal of interest from customers. So we know there are, for example, some tickets around the Trio annual springs to mind, where we're selling such a low number of tickets, so it kind of doesn't really make sense why we got that ticket. So let's think about it. Finally, we want to then migrate products to the Borders platform where it's makes sense to do so. And we want to build on the same approach that we've got today, so use the same tools that are already in our bag, leverage existing technologies, we know they work, we know we can cope with the throughput. We can keep the simple proposition that we've got to date and build on the knowledge, awareness and learning both within the people offering the ticket as well as the customers using the tickets. Improve our driver knowledge and build Borders brand even further within our region. Secondly, we want to look at then enhancing functionality. And just some of the ideas that we've been kicking around there include collecting customer data in terms of registering people against the cards and moving away from that anonymous card approach. Sharing the data between Merseytravel and operators, and that's particularly key if we're thinking about Borders as the platform that operators may choose to use. We might hold and manage data that is actually not belonging to Merseytravel or the actual commercial business. And we're looking at new retail solutions, for example, the ability to sell smart cards and actually on the bus to travel, at rail stations, on the internet online, and also the ability to hotlist. So if a card is lost, stolen, then we do have the ability to kill that card and then prototype, which is a very high level approach. Just wanted you to be aware of this. There are some decisions that are going on outside of the sphere of the smart ticketing program that have a significant impact on the way that we have to live. So for example, the Bus Alliance has been considering options around, could we consider moving away from multiple zones to a single zone, and all the pros and cons that go with that, and I'll leave that for the Bus Alliance people. However, the implications for the smart ticketing group are quite significant. So if we take what we've currently got being the same way and the solo, and we move from the multiple zones to the one, you'll see that at the moment we have something like 40 product variations. If we make that decision, that immediately drops to 8. So if you can take that same principle and apply it to all new products, you can see the amount of effort to do new things is significantly less. On the converse of that, the longer we wait to make those sorts of decisions, the more work we have to do to go back and pick 40 products to put in 8 new ones. So there are things that are going on just to explain some of the complexities that aren't necessarily smart ticketing per se, but have a significant impact, and I just want to use that as an example. So where's all that gone? And all that's gone into a 3-year plan. We've crafted a plan which is large and quite complex, and very difficult to show today. So I'm just giving you a little picture there in the top right hand corner. You can get your magnifying glass on that later. So we drafted that plan, we've shared it with our partner operators, we've shared it with our own internal Merseytravel staff actually this morning. We've also shared it with the DfT Smart Cities Partnership Group to make sure that what we're doing is aligned to other areas of the country. using that platform, creating additional products within that same set, we're not confusing things. So if I give you an example, if our walls platform is Lego, then we don't want to then go and use Stagecoach and Duplo and Arriva and Meccano and try and add it all together. What we're saying is let's stick with Lego, and therefore we can build and shape our product set and our ticketing solution, what we want more easily, more quickly. That's the best analogy I can give you. So we've got really good progress on that. We've agreed that we're going to move the existing prepaid tickets to Walrus where it makes sense to. Stagecoach and Arriva have both agreed independently to fully use our platform for their own weekly tickets, so their own Stagecoach weekly and Arriva weekly, entirely onto the Walrus platform for those people in Merseytravel. So that's a very big win. And we're working closely, as Jan alluded to a little earlier on, with Merseytravel to deliver smart ticketing solutions, particularly in early 2016, specifically mentioned before was the Braille Pass, just being one of those many. So just finally then, next steps is we're looking to finalise those plans to particularly around that simplify, rationalise and digitise aspect, and get those tickets onto the Walrus platform. We're looking to finalise the resource requirements, as I said, people and finances. And we're looking as well to continue the engagement with TFN, Transport for the North, and looking at the intelligent back office and leveraging what's going on across the Mann and other regions. That's the question.
Brilliant. Thanks, Gary. Any questions or comments? Go on. Number 10.
Yeah, I'd just like to say I'm very pleased to see the achievements that are being made by the team. And we also include that accolade to my colleague, Councillor Norris, as well, because I know he's very interested in the horizon on these, and I dare say anything about his tongue soon because they get along there, along with responsible why things can't be done. One of the ways that you look in the future is account base and things like that. More and more people are concerned now about how data is held about them and shared with others and the loss of that data into the wider area. Is that something that you're starting to give a bit more thought to them? Is it within our experience and knowledge base to do that?
Absolutely. We have both a moral and a legal obligation around data management. So we are looking at how we handle that data technically, securely, and all those sorts of things. But also in terms of whose data it is, and ultimately it's the customer's data, but who has their permission to see and use that data appropriately. So before we even get down to databases and sharing and how we can use it, there is the legalities of a data sharing principle and agreements as to how all that fits together in the scheme and how what we can use it for thereafter. So it's all in there to be considered. Thinking is very early on that, but it is certainly complex. But there are other sectors in particular that we can look to learn lessons from.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks, Gary. I'm glad to have also got the. I know Winston doesn't operate. in a short period of time, considering the amount of time it took for an oyster card to come through to what it is. And the oyster situation was about people trying to hack into the system where it went down. So I think that the problems about data protection is very, very important. We have the security in place to make sure that these things don't happen to our back office system. But I think, you know, we have to realise that we can't be an oyster card. And nobody can be an oyster card. An oyster card is distinct to the Travel Board of London and the area of London. It was developed for that particular purpose. We have to develop our own card and make the Woolworths card compatible with the oyster card. But a Merseyside compatibility, that's what we're into here. And I just get a bit frustrated when we keep quoting the oyster card. And that's probably disrespectful anyway. But we have to understand that the oyster card is 20 years. We're trying to develop something that we've only been developing probably for 2 years properly. We played around with it for 3 years or so, when it's going to deal with cinema tickets and taking it to go to the baths and taking it to do this and taking it to do that, which he never was designed to do. And we're probably at the forefront of being into developing anyway, because I think the ITSO has been a bit of a nightmare to develop upon, but it's a preferred option by the government that we should be using. I think we have to make the best of that. Well, I think will be eventually be a very, very good product that will deliver a great service to people in Merseyside.
Yeah.
Just finally, I think, and that goes to the credit back to the politicians for the office who really were.
Absolutely. Gary, do you
want to? If I may, the Oyster card is indeed very different, as is the ticket to the management model compared to our own environment. That being said, there are obviously some lessons that we can learn from 20 years of pain and suffering. I'm sure my counterpart at TfL will tell me that. But there are some lessons that can be learned. It's a different challenge, a different environment we face. But certainly, yeah, we will look and we constantly work as a team with Smart Cities Partnership to learn those lessons and bring them to bear what we're doing in our walks.
Yeah, thanks for that, Gary. I'll just echo what Ron said as well. I don't think we should lose sight of the fact of how far we've come in a very short period of time. Just to think over the past couple of years, we've really got under the skin of this, got it out there, got it working. And when you think about the fact that we've got 800,000 cards out there, the most active scheme by usage anywhere outside of London, we've raced past Birmingham, we've raced past Leeds. What you even mentioned, Greater Manchester, abortive launch. The fact that we are where we are puts us premier position for smart ticketing in the North of England. I'm sure that what we look to do across the North through Transport for the North will be based on a lot of learning that came out of the Liverpool City region. And yeah, just as Ron did, I want to pay tribute to yourselves, Liz, Gary, the rest of the team have been working so hard on this and have actually made this a reality over the past couple of years. And particularly it's great to see when you're going through the presentation how dependent on getting it all signed off, all of the operators have signed up to the principle of using the Walrus card as the ticketing platform. That's not about us controlling the ticketing, it's about keeping it simple and straightforward for the passenger. Because if we had a load of different plastic cards out there with different brands, nobody would use them. If we keep it simple and straightforward, just like Oyster has been in London, that is one way we'll get more people using not just the Walrus, but more importantly using public transport as a choice to get around. So really well done on that. I think it's great that we're focusing on where we want to take things in terms of keeping things simple and straightforward. We want to understand in more depth and detail about the simplification of zones and things like that to make sure we get it right and that there isn't a financial penalty for customers, because at the end of the day it's important we've got smart ticketing, but actually affordable ticketing is the most important aspect of ticketing on the transport network. And I think the key thing is it's great we've got a plan going forward and that we're just as impatient as Jan is to actually crack on with smart ticketing right across the piece. So with all of that, thanks ever so much. Look forward to future updates, and if we can note the presentation, call for further updates accordingly, if that can be agreed. Right, last couple of items then, under any urgent AOB. The first one, 8A, is with regard to the performance and review subcommittee. And if I can ask Councillor Stockton just to move those minutes and also give us the names of the people that will be chairing the performance and review subcommittee task and finish groups. John.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to move the minutes of the performance and review subcommittee held on the 4th of January 2016, please. And secondly, the names for all of that, let's move the motion.
Agreed? Excellent. Okay, 8B, the last item, National Infrastructure Commission submission and data.